Hello everybody, thank you very much, the warm welcome. So, I'm Árpád Goretity, and tonight I'm going to talk about my programming language called Sparkling. Let me introduce myself just briefly. I'm carbonic acid, or H2CO3, on the internet on various platforms. I'm a first year bachelor of bionics at Pazman University of Budapest, and I'm a long time programming aficionado, meaning that I've been programming for more than 10 years now. I've started programming when I was 9, and I have used more than 10 languages. You know, I'm not an expert in more than 10 languages, but I have some insights as to what these languages are good for and what the various good and bad aspects of these languages are. So, little schedule. My talk is going to be about 40 minutes long, and after we are doing some demos of the language of the scripting engine, and you can of course ask questions afterwards, and we will discuss them. Regarding questions, I have set up a little web server at the IP address shown on the screen. And my goal is that if you have any questions during the presentation, please don't hesitate to ask them using the form that you can see there. My intent is with this is that you don't have to keep the questions yourselves, you don't have to forget them, and you don't have to distract me either from the presentation. Okay. So, you know, the first impression of a programming language comes through the syntax. So here's what Sparkling looks like. Oh, well, no, just kidding. This is how it actually looks like. You can notice that it's similar to a number of languages you may be familiar with. For example, JavaScript and C. And, you know, the design philosophy behind this language is kind of that I try to combine the good parts of some popular and highly demanded and proved languages such as JavaScript, C, Lua, and Python, and maybe many others, and take the good parts of these languages or the parts I liked the most and combine them into one single language so as to create something that I can like and I can use the way I wish. Okay, so I hear you asking, but why? Why yet another scripting language? And sort of, you know, this question is sort of justified because we have already enough languages out there, don't we? But I felt that it's necessary because, you know, almost every language I have worked with so far had some little inconvenient quirks that I didn't quite like, and I decided that I just can't live with those problems. So let me enumerate some of these problems which largely influenced the design decisions behind Sparkling. First thing is type systems. Types are kind of convenient and important to have in a programming language, since you know the human brain tries to and likes to categorize things because that's easier to do all the sorts of work. And because of what areas of mathematics such as type theory have developed over the course of centuries. Well, but unfortunately, some languages have got a quite screwed up type system. For example, we have JavaScript. Yeah, I hear you laughing. In JavaScript, for example, equality is not a transitive operation. Meaning, you know, common sense would expect that if the string 0 is equal to the number 0, and the number 0 is equal to an empty array, that obviously the string 0 must be equal to the empty array, right? Well, it isn't. And that's the problem with that is that JavaScript tries to implicitly make sense of nonsensical things. You know, comparing zero with an empty array doesn't really make sense to me. Maybe there are people out there who disagree, but for me this is kind of disturbing. So in Sparkling, all these things correctly evaluate to false. Okay. Well, what else? I'm also an iOS application developer, so I care about mobile devices and mobile platforms a lot. And sometimes it can be convenient to be able to extend your language or your application with some sort of scripting language. For example, if you're developing a game and you want your users to be able to extend the game with custom levels or custom characters or capabilities of certain characters, or, you know, most modern text editors and IDEs have scriptability. And even Photoshop or GIMP have, if I recall correctly, Python scripting. That's a good thing because it makes your application way more flexible than it would be otherwise. But the problem with most scripting languages is that a decent implementation is huge. So, for example, I've checked some informations on GitHub. Of implementations. Would you like your iOS application to be 200 megabytes bigger just because it has Python scriptability? Well, personally, I wouldn't. Another obvious choice for scripting language for extension is JavaScript. You know, everyone does and knows JavaScript these days. Everyone loves it, everyone hates it. But, you know, the sort of the king of JavaScript is, of course, the king of web, Google. But Google's V8 engine, it could be called Wait, actually, because it's 94 megabytes big, at least when I last checked it out, it was so. So I ask you, what would be an acceptable amount of code you would spend on a scripting engine? Is maybe 150 kilobytes enough? Because that's what the size of the Sparkling engine is. Now, computer science and programming has developed in a close relation with mathematics. And as such, numbers are a very important aspect of a programmer's life. We do all sorts of computations with our programs. And while we are doing computations, we often forget that we are not being precise or exact. The numeric programmers' sort of evilest and worst enemies are floating point numbers. Because, you know, the vast majority of floating point implementations influence the IEEE standard, which is a binary floating point representation, and that doesn't map too well to the common understanding of our decimal number system. So, for example, you can do all sorts of interesting things whereby 0.1 plus 0.2 doesn't equal 0.0 just because of the error of the representation. Scripting languages tend to simplify and abstract away a lot of stuff. You know, and that's good. That's the point of the scripting language. It has to be easy to use. It has to be productive. But one thing that I think scripting languages oversimplify is numbers. A lot of programming scripting languages don't have separate number types, just one number type, which is a floating point, either a float or a double or maybe an extended precision representation. But you know, that doesn't quite work out always. For example, if you take the following Lua code, you know, in the age of 64-bit computers, you would expect your computer to be able to deal with 64-bit numbers. If you run this Lua code, you can get the unexpected result that a large enough number, integer number, is equal to 1 plus that number. That's obviously wrong. Well, Sparkling has this sort of novel feature in among programming languages, and this is one of the reasons I like Python. Similarly to Python, Sparkling has got two integer types. So the equivalent code, 2 to the 54th power plus 1, this evaluates the false, so as you would expect. Programs are mostly done for their side effects. Side effects are the useful things that make program, you know, at all useful, and that's kind of the point of making a program. You know, there are functional programming languages too, but you know, you still have to do something so that you can interact with the outside world. It turns out that in most modern programming languages, we use operators to create side effects. We use all sorts of operators. Apart from performing computations, we use operators with branching to make logical decisions. We use operators to call functions. We use operators to look up things in arrays and hash tables and so on. So operators are kind of a central point of a modern programming language. Well, one aspect which can go wrong with operators is operator precedence. You know, C is a brilliant language. It's my favorite language, but not even C is perfect. In particular, I think that the order, the precedence of operators, or the order of evaluation, which are not to be confused, by the way, sometimes it's not the best possible choice. For example, in C and C derivative languages, you can do sort of bitwise comparisons and get unexpected results. For example, JavaScript and Java designers decided not to reorder the operator precedence because the common thought goes like that. This looks like C, so C programmers must be feel comfortable with this language. So they decided to copy the sometimes wrong operator precedence from C. So in JavaScript, 8 bitwise and 8 apparently isn't equal to 8. Well, what happens is that the equality operator has a greater precedence than the bitwise end, and so you keep ending the 8 with 1, and that's a 0. In Sparkling, I have a bit shuffled the operator precedence, so this does what it looks like it's doing without explicit and, frankly, quite of an ugly parenthesizing. Okay, back to specifically scripting languages. Scripting languages don't usually have linkers and header files and declarations. That's for, of course, practical purposes. And sometimes it's the convenience of the programmer who implements the language. But as a result of this, often these scripting languages share state between files and translation units using global variables. And global variables can also be weird and surprising, the source of surprising behavior. The problem with global variables is because there are no declarations, you can the compiler, when it encounters an undeclared identifier, it sort of implies a global variable instead of throwing a compile time error. For example, can you spot the error in this piece of code? Well, not easy. You know, there's a missing var keyword causing that J variable to be an implied global and global state. I mean, this is obvious once it's pointed out, right? In Sparkling, I've changed this because a reference to undeclared global variables generates errors, hard errors. Reading generates a runtime error, and writing to an undeclared global generates a compile time error. What else? Now comes the toughest part, kind of. I've already mentioned that scripting languages must be sort of productive and fast. And that's why usually in scripting languages we don't want the programmer to to have to worry about explicit memory management. And thus, scripting languages have automatic memory management. Now, the sort of silver bullet in automatic management is these days is garbage collection, which is, you know, a nice little technique. It has been researched for a long, and it has proven to be useful and working. But the thing is that garbage collection is not always the best ultimate solution to automatic memory management. So let's talk about garbage collection a bit. There are programming environments like desktop computers or highly powerful servers when we use all sorts of garbage counted scripting languages, Python, JavaScript. Java is also reference counted. And you know, when you have a high-end server or a decent desktop machine, that works out quite well. But what if you are on a mobile device? In a memory-constrained environment, where also CPU cycles are limited, garbage collection can become quite tedious. And that's why automatic memory management techniques have been invented. For example, Apple has this. I think Apple has gotten beautifully well. They use in their Objective-C language, which is a native programming language, it's a derivative of C. They use something called automatic reference counting. Objects are just normally reference counted, and the compiler can deduce where and when to increase and decrease the reference count of objects. Well, Android Java still use garbage collection, and some Android users have reported lags and hiccups in the user experience of certain well-known programs and games, and a fairly decent amount of these hiccups have been tracked down by the developers to the fact that the garbage collector was kicking in at the wrong time. This is what garbage collection's characteristics looks like. Maybe if you are a desktop or server web developer, you might have been spending the entire life your entire life in the right part of the graph. The x-axis shows the amount of memory of the program with garbage collection, compared to the amount of memory it would require if we didn't have garbage collection enabled. The chart shows you that as long as you have at least 5 or 6 times as many memory as you would need otherwise, garbage collection runs just fine. But as long as you have less than 4 or 3 times as much memory as you would need, then garbage collection starts to slow down your application exponentially. This chart it's not my creation. This is a part of a quite lengthy article by the author of the Sealed Abstract blog. On the page I've showed you for the questions, I have put a link to this article. It's quite long and very deep and very technical, so it's worth a read, definitely. And the author of this article explains very well why garbage collection can be the wrong solution actually on mobile platforms. So, you know, if you're on a mobile device such as Android, you may be in the left hand side of this chart. That's not something you want to do. So Sparking uses automatic reference counting, and we will see some consequences of that in the demo. And the list goes on. You know, as we could hear from Gábor, all programming languages suck. There is no exception. For example, two reasons I've also decided to put on this slide is a lot of languages which have native extension capabilities, such as Lua and Python, have a C API that is maybe too complex. For example, Lua has this stack-based API where you have a stack and you can index it explicitly, but at the same time you have to keep the stack indices because it's indexable. The stack indices in your head. For me, it didn't work out very well. So Sparkling C API is as simple as possible. I want to make this API friendly and easy to use. Of course, this is subjective, and some of you will disagree, and that's fine. But this is, you know, sort of my personal experience. Also, there's the question of syntax. I have already told a bit about syntax. Syntax is very important because it's kind of the connection between our brains and the computer. So if a language's syntax encourages errors and encourages mistakes, and it can be misleading, that's not good because, you know, you will have more bugs and you will be less productive. Did you hear about the recent Apple SSL bug? I have also put a link to the explanation of this bug on the page I've showed you. The problem was that in C, after a conditional, an if statement, you don't have to put explicit braces. If the statement body is just one statement, you can omit the braces. And presumably, this caused this very nasty SSL bug in Apple's code. So yeah, by the way, in Sparkling, those braces are always required. Yeah. So I was asked to talk a bit about the actual implementation of the Sparkling scripting engine and explain how I created it and how to create one. Well, some important points. I want Sparkling to be portable and, you know, the ease of use also constitutes of being it being easy to compile. So Sparkling is written in strict C89. It's implemented as a drop-in library, so you have an IDE, you have makefiles, whatever you use for building your applications, you can very easily incorporate the library. And it has no external dependencies. It only relies on the very C89 standard library. Yeah, it's a library, of course. The Sparkling engine is modular in its architecture. The first, it has basically four parts: the parser and compiler, the virtual machine, the standard libraries, and various helper components. I wanted to keep the implementation as simple as possible because, you know, that's good for the language to extend. Others can easily understand your code. Your later yourself can easily understand the code if you want to go back and modify something. And for an experimental language like Sparkling, it's sort of important. So there are some decisions. What do we use for lexing the language? Regular expressions, right? Well, no. In Sparkling, I didn't use any regular expressions. There are multiple reasons for that. Firstly, and most foremost, regular expressions are incapable of lexing Sparkling because of, you know, string escaping and all sorts of tricky stuff, numbers. And also, regular expressions are not a standard C feature. So I didn't want to rely on the POSIX API. I didn't want to rely on per-compatible regular expressions. And quite frankly, regular expressions are horrible. The parser is a purely recursive descent parser. Again, that's for simplicity and for ease of modification. Because, you know, if you have a recursive descent parser, then the code structure sort of follows the grammar of the language. And that's good because then you can go back and modify it as easily as possible, wherever you want. And of course, there is the code generator, which takes the abstract syntax tree produced by the parser, and it generates bytecode for the virtual machine. It performs no optimizations. If you want true speed, then go use C or C++ or maybe an assembler. In the context of a scripting language, it's most often out of scope. And also, if I wanted to do optimizations, I would have probably had to use an external library such as LLVM, and that's huge, and it's not standard, so I didn't want to do that. I have mentioned simplicity, but don't get me wrong, simplicity doesn't mean that you just sit down and code without thinking. So I've quite carefully designed the implementation, and as such, the virtual machine is a register-based one. I have been thinking about this a lot because, frankly, at the moment where I began implementing Sparkling, I had virtually no idea how to generate code for a register-based virtual machine. But then I told myself, yeah, you have to be able to do that. It must not be that complex, and indeed it wasn't. It took some nice little graph theory to just work out the algorithm. It was quite straightforward. The virtual machine is, they're all sort of runtime trickery, and as such, reference counting is happening. So that's just that. A key concept of the implementation of the virtual machine is symbol tables. There are two types of symbol tables in the virtual machine. One is a global symbol table where all global objects are stored, such as functions and containers of libraries which are implemented as hash tables. And there is also another type of symbol table which is a local one. Each file, each translation unit has one, and it contains string literals and references to global symbols. And I've put the standard library on this slide because, you know, it's nothing special at all, actually. The standard library is just a predefined set of functions, of normal C extension functions, which are just added to the virtual machine by default. Okay, so let's talk about performance. Of course, everybody is worrying about performance because you have to be fast and whatever. The thing is that performance is not that important that sometimes we might think. Of course, systems programmers and compiler designers and game programmers and server administrators should think about performance a lot. But in some contexts, there are quite a few contexts where performance is just downright irrelevant. So very few people actually should worry about performance that much. I've said this one before, it's pretty critical, you see. Scripting languages nowadays tend to have JIT compilers, which is very nice. Your scripting language can be an order of magnitude faster with the JIT compilation than without that, or even maybe more. I am planning to make a JIT for Sparkling in a separate project for the reasons I've mentioned before. You know, Sparkling proved to be still reasonably fast because of the higher level design decisions I've made. Okay. We are going to do some demos. What I have done is, first I have taken a few algorithms and little programs from the computer language benchmark game and from SunSpider, and I have also created my own test cases, and I have tried to write identical algorithms in Sparkling, C, JavaScript, Python, and Lua, and I have measured their performance using the Unix utility time. I have run these programs on my MacBook, which is a MacBook Pro from early 2010. You know, it's got a very decent processor speed and amount of memory. And here are the implementations of the languages I have used. C is compiled using the Clang or LLVM toolchain. JavaScript is just Apple's built-in JavaScript core, which has an Agile compiler. So JavaScript is essentially native code. And Python is just the standard C Python. I think it's 3.3.3 or something like that. I have measured 10 runs of the algorithms or programs. I have discarded the highest and the lowest result. I have abridged the remaining 8. So before I run the demos, let me show you just a few charts which are the result of running these programs. I'm sure some of you will be familiar with Ackermann's function. It's a recursive function of which the running time is growing very fast with its arguments growing fast or very slowly. Well, here I have run Ackermann's function for the same with the same arguments, and the results are quite nice. The C program running, you know, just a few dozens of milliseconds. JavaScript has proved quite good, and Sparkling is just a little bit slower than Lua, and I think that's quite nice because, you know, Lua is sort of considered to be one of the fastest not cheated scripting languages. Now comes the real surprise. There is a binary trees program in the computer language benchmarks game, and so I have created a program, or actually 5 programs, which allocate and deallocate a lot of binary trees. Here's the result. So you can see that Sparkling has outperformed Lua in this benchmark. And then we have just the standard Fibonacci function, quite expected results. We have numeric integration, where Python has proven a little bit worse than the other languages, and you know, we have prime search. This one was nice because it shows that actually, you know, JavaScript can be faster than C because of the runtime, the ability to optimize code at runtime because of the just-in-time compiler. And for the sake of it, I have made a busy wait loop, just an empty loop which runs, I think, 100 million times. These were the results. You know, Sparkling is quite well in this test as well. Okay, so let's see. You know, let's see a few demos. I have implemented. Here it is. So I have implemented just a little bash script, which does the following. It compiles the appropriate C code, runs it, and then uses the JavaScript, Sparkling, Go, and Python programs just to prove this in front of you. Let's try running. You know, we have these demos, the Ackermann, the B-tree, the Fibonacci, etc. So for example, if we run the binary trees programs, here it is. So we can see that C has finished in 200 milliseconds, JavaScript has finished in 100 milliseconds, and I've googled a bit in order to know, you know, why this is, and I've determined that you know, a lot of sort of smart programmers say that the thing why JavaScript has been faster this time. Here it is. is that in JavaScript the memory is.
It seems that JavaScript is
crashed.
Right?
Oh no, it hasn't. Undefined is just the return value of the it just prints the return value of the function of the translation unit that has been run. And unfortunately, in JavaScript there is no printing facility built in the language, so I couldn't print the numbers. Those are just the iteration counter, which is being run. You know, I will show the code soon, and you will see what it is. So in JavaScript, the memory for the binary trees is allocated in one contiguous chunk. And thus, a quasi-malloc, an allocation JavaScript, doesn't actually result in syscalls, whereas in C, it does have to perform the syscalls. Okay. Sparking finished in 1.4 seconds, and Lua finished in 1.5 seconds. Yeah, you know, Python is a bit off. So we have these benchmarks. We can open the code because it's, you know, we have this here. And this is the Python code. All the code does is it makes it has a make-two function. It's a recursive function. If it's passed zero as the defs, it returns nil or none in Python. If it's not, then it returns a node with just the data argument, just in order to have a data argument in there, and then left and right subtrees which have one smaller depth. So it terminates quite nicely. So ultimately, this, because I have put in 20 for the loop counter, it ends up generating 2 to the 20, which is about 1 million, so trees of 1 million nodes. The C implementation is a bit more complex, of course. We have to worry about explicit memory management. But, you know, this is just the same algorithm. We have the recursive function. We free the tree after the iteration, and so on. In Sparkling, this is it. You know, it's very simple again. And incidentally, this step has opened next to the JavaScript. This is quite similar. You see, the syntax is almost identical. Not always, because, you know, Sparkling has some simplifications, such as it doesn't require the loops to be wrapped in parentheses and so on. But, you know, it looks familiar. And the Lua code, fortunately, the Lua is nice and readable. This is the same thing, really. The reason we have 19 there is because in Lua, for the for loops are so the for loops have closed intervals. So here I runs from 8 to 19 inclusive. I have made yet another kind of demo. I have compiled Sparkling to run on my iPad, and I have made a little wrapper in Sparkling around the graphics library of iOS, which is called Core Graphics. It's a nice C-based API. It's object-oriented, so it was quite very easy to port. So I have just made a little wrapper around it, and I have made a little demo program, which is a graphing calculator. You know, you type in a function, and it plots the function for you within the specified interval. Well, unfortunately, we don't have an appropriate cable, so I can't show you this on the screen now. But if you wish so, then after the presentation, you can come here and see how it operates. It's fairly smooth, although all the computation and all the prepped drawing code is done in Sparkling. So, you know, it's very, very good. Yeah, back to the presentations. This is how it looks like, sort of. I have made a
a syntax highlighting text view for this demo application on my iPad. So it looks nice. Is that the program just draws the function and draws its derivative as well. It uses simple numeric derivation. What's nice is the resolution of the iPad screen is, well, the logical resolution at least, it's 1024 by 768 pixels, and despite, you know, the code has to go through all these two along the x-axis, all these 2000 pixels, and at 60 FPS, and it still runs smoothly. So you can make it to 60 FPS with sparkling. Okay, so some sort of conclusion before we leave. So Sparkling is a new, simple and small, dynamic scripting language. At the same time, it's strict, so it won't try to make sense of your mess, whatever it is. So it kind of enforces sanity, yet it tries to be productive. I have some future plans with Sparkling as well. My intent is that it be used as an extension language because of its simplicity and size. It's also kind of friendly. It looks familiar to C and JavaScript programmers, and it could be. One of my friends told me once that it could be a good first language because it's, you know, it's kind of strict, but it's still not a pain to learn. Okay, and that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And I kindly ask you to check out my Twitter account and the source code of the Sparkling engine on GitHub. And now, I don't know if you have asked any questions using my form during the presentation. We will see that, and we will discuss these questions if you wish so. So, thank you very much. Awesome. Yeah, kind of cool questions. Thank you very much. Why semicolons? Because without semicolons, the grammar is ambiguous. So you can see that in Lua there are no semicolons. And because there are no semicolons, you can, for example, break a function call into multiple lines, which is sort of annoying if you have more than a few arguments. You shouldn't, but you know, it's best to keep the syntax consistent, so the parser can be easy. How could you achieve the immense runtime size reduction compared to JavaScript, for example? Does it come with some kind of a compromise? Runtime size is in the size of the implementation, I guess, yeah. Of course it does come with a compromise. The simple implementation of Sparkling does not include a just-in-time compiler. And this is basically the one reason. You know, I mean, Lua is fairly small as well. It's about 1 megabyte with the documentation. So you know, because there is no just-in-time compiler, the grammar is small as well. So you know, when you have a small grammar, you can reduce the size of both the parser and the lexer and the code generator. And also the virtual machine, because you don't have to worry about implementing too much instructions. Have you heard about region-based memory management? It's a kind of compiler and garbage collection. It's used in more language with Cyclone. I have heard about Cyclone, but I haven't yet heard about region-based memory management, I guess. Thank you for bringing this to my attention. I will look after that, I think, because it sounds interesting. What kind of tooling support does your language have? Does it have an IDE or at least an Eclipse plugin? Is there a profiler for it? Does it support TDD? Is there a testing framework? Yeah. Nice. Not little, but nice question. You know, I, as you have probably perceived, I use Gedit. So that's the tooling support. And indeed, in the GitHub repository, there is a syntax highlighting file for Gedit. So if you also a mesochist and you use Gedit, then you can install that plugin and you can have nice syntax highlighting for your sparkling code. I am planning to write a debugger, which I think will be in the core library, because a debugger is really, really nice and it saves you from a lot of pain. TDD, sorry, no TDD support. Testing framework. I have mostly made manual tests and little, you know, demo and test programs. I was busy enough with implementing the core library and testing it to the point that I could release it to GitHub. It took me quite a few months. You know, I go to school and I don't have a lot of time to work on this language. So I don't know if or when there will be a testing framework. It would be definitely nice because, oftentimes I encounter some nasty bug in the compiler, in the virtual machine, etc., which by accident, which could be eliminated if I had a proper testing framework for Spartan. What is the maturity of the language? Is it production ready? Well, the language is not a mature language. I have been, the idea of the language has born in late 2012. I have started working on it in late 2013. And so, you know, it's sort of half a year old. So it's not a language that you will see in production. My plan is that if the community accepts it and the programmers like it, and I will have more time to work on it, then I think it could become a fairly decent language, you know, because it has some good ideas and it tried to fix some common errors found in other programming languages. It could be a good replacement, for example, I don't know, JavaScript or whatever. Is there a specific target area? No. I'd like it to be general purpose. The reason I want it to be general purpose is that so that more people can use it and more people can benefit from using it. As I mentioned, it is especially good as an extension language. As an extension language, it's good because it's small and you can, using the libraries, the native extension functions, you can tailor it to your needs. It seems like these were the questions. Thank you very much once again. And if now you have questions, yes.
Can I have one more question?
Of course.
Actually, it wasn't working on my phone, so let me post my question. So you mentioned garbage collection, yeah, which is, of course, a big problem with Java. There are a lot of jokes about it. But the other problem is the problem of circular references, right?
Yep.
So, And as long as you don't have circular references, then there's no real problem with garbage collection because a simple reference coupling is fine. And my question is that I don't really know this automatic reference coupling algorithm. How does it solve the problem of circular references?
It doesn't, yeah. I was prepared for this question. It's nice. It is fair that, of course, reference counting has its own those signs, so honestly. You can have circular references in Sparkling with the current implementation of reference counting. So if you, for example, put an array inside another array and then you back reference that array, arrays are objects, so they keep retaining themselves. So that can be a problem, but if you are coding well, you shouldn't create these sort of errors, because it really, very rarely it is the case that you have to use circular references.
Like, except for graphs.
Yeah, for graphs it's kind of inevitable. Yeah, I should definitely think about that problem before I can I dare to say that Sparkling is production ready. Yes, I'm aware of it, and thank you for mentioning it and bringing it up. Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. point of this meetup is to meet up. So, we have beer. Don't go home now, right now. Go home a bit later. Drink a beer and talk to someone you don't know about the topic. That's the rule, okay? Why don't you introduce yourself to someone you don't know right now? Of course, we all try, we will download it, buy it, the books and the training is included. So, why don't you introduce yourself to someone you don't know? Like this, I show you, hi, I meet you. And then you can start a conversation, is he crazy or genius?
He's crazy.
So this is what you are going supposed to do, beer is there, pizza is there, coffee is there, whatever. Thank you for coming. See you next time.